Hi, Panagiotis, Roilos, thanks for joining us today at this modest celebration of the 50th anniversary of Joseph Seferis' death. This year marks important anniversaries for the Greek world, including also the 200 years after the Greek War of Independence, which here at Harvard we honored with a two-day international conference co-organized with the Economist Chair of the Fletcher School of Arts last week. Today would not have been possible without the generous help and support of Ilana Friedman, PhD candidate in comparative literature, Dr. Calliope Dourou, preceptor in modern Greek, my dear colleague David Emeros, Ernest Birnbaum Professor of Comparative Literature and Chair of the Department of Comparative Literature, my dear colleague David Elmer, Elliott Professor of Ancient Greek Literature and Chair of the Department of Classics, and Mr. Stratos Efthymiou, Consul General of Greece in Boston. I am most grateful to all of them. And of course, invaluable is the contribution of all those who will recite poems this afternoon. I have already mentioned some of these, but let me gratefully add also the names of Nate Herter, PhD candidate in classics, Lubi Kiriakidi, PhD candidate in classics, and Cleo Takas, PhD candidate in comparative literature. So now, the Consul General of Greece here in Boston, Mr. Stratos Efthymiou, will say a few things. I don't know if you, David, want to say something.
I would just add that I'm personally very delighted to be here today, and I'm so pleased that so many are here to join us in the celebration of George Seferis, who has obviously such an extraordinary literary voice, and so I'm just very, very pleased to be here, and I would like to join you, Panagiotis, in welcoming everyone.
Thank you, David. So, Mr. Efthymiou.
Hello, everybody, and I would like to warmly salute this timely initiative of Professor Roilos, the George Seferis Professor of Modern Greek Studies and Professor of Comparative Literature. The Consulate General of Greece in Boston is very honored to co-sponsor this event. The 50th anniversary since the passing of George Seferis is a great occasion to pay tribute to George Seferis, the first Greek Nobel laureate and a tireless ambassador of Greek language. Seferis was a colossal spiritual figure with a deep knowledge and a conscience of history, coming himself from the roots of the Hellenic tradition and shouldering a rare sense of mission. He was an outstanding career diplomat who honored the Hellenic Republic, serving in crucial postings in very decisive moments of modern Greek history. And he was very deeply marked, haunted by the loss of his motherland and the Asia Minor catastrophe, the uprooting of 1.5 million Greeks in 1922. During his diplomatic service abroad, he lived close to Hellenic diasporic communities in Egypt, Jerusalem, Turkey, South Africa, Albania, Cyprus, and he was in constant dialogue with the history of the geographical landscape. But it would be a mistake to imprison Seferis in a Greek shell. Seferis was in open dialogue with the international contemporary currents of his time, which he enriched by highlighting the Greek historic tradition and his language's ecumenical value. As Heaney says about Seferis, quote, his poems resonate beyond their immediate Greek context. By retracting the particular historical tragedy of Asia Minor Greeks through the ancient motifs of Odyssean voyage and deferred homecoming, Seferis also expressed something of the whole mood of Europe and the times, unquote. 50 years after Seferis traveled to the underworld, I want to congratulate Professor Roilos for today's event that highlights the intellectual conversation of Seamus Heaney with Seferis. Most importantly, I feel the need to personally thank Panagiotis Roilos, who was the person who initiated Seamus Heaney's deep engagement with the work of Seferis, engagement which gave us, among other things, Heaney's George Seferis in the Underworld. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Efthymiou, for your generous words. So the event has been structured as follows. I will give a short talk on Seferis, focusing on Seamus Heaney's reading of his poetry. And after my talk, poetry readings of Seferis's and Seamus Heaney's poems will follow. The title of my talk today is George Seferis in the Underworld, reading Seferis with Seamus Heaney. Yes, said the proconsul, replacing the scroll. Indeed, the line is true and beautiful, Sophocles at his most philosophical. We'll talk about a whole lot more down there and be happy to be seen for what we are. Here, we are like sentries, watching anxiously, guarding every locked up hurt and secret. But all we cover up here, day and night, down there we let out, frankly and completely. That is, said the sophist with a slow half smile, if down there they ever talk about such things, if they can be bothered with the like at all. This is how Seamus Heaney has rendered Cavafis' poem, Ta Dhala Enadho Tis Kato Mithisome. The rest I'll speak of to the ones below in Hades. He has included his translation in his poetry book, District and Circle, 2006. In his text, Cavafi, in his usual subtly ironic manner, comments on a belief that in Greek tradition can be traced back to the Homeric epics, most notably to Book 11 of the Odyssey. Although mere shadows, phantoms of their earthly existence, the dead in the underworld interact with each other and in certain cases and in ways that transcend natural laws with living people. Despite the fact that this idea was famously ridiculed by Lucian in the second century CE, or by the author of the 12th century Byzantine satire, Timarion, it has more or less survived through labyrinthine processes of continuity and discontinuity and in innumerable versions in oral literature, the so-called popular religion, and most creatively in the imagination of poets from Virgil to Dante to Seferis to Heaney and so many others. In the same poetry book, Seamus Heaney decided to include also his poem to the George Seferis in the Underworld. Drawing from ancient rhetorical tradition, one might want to read Heaney's address to Seferis as an ethopoeia, a character study, and slightly rewrite its title in accordance with the genre conventions of ethopoeia as follows. What words would Seamus Heaney say to George Seferis if he ever meets him in the underworld? 50 years have passed since George Seferis has been down there, and another 8 since Seamus joined him in the meadow of the Asphodels. Although my view on metaphysical, eschatological issues tends to be Lucianic, the suppressed poet in me cannot help conjuring up the image of the Irish poet having a scroll with an autograph of that Ethiopia-like poem to George Seferis in the Underworld. But it's time I dealt with more down-to-earth points. Seamus' poem to his fellow Nobel laureate Greek, an eloquent testament to the latter's long-lasting impact on world literature, was the result of his gradual systematic familiarization with Seferis' work. This began in late 1999, when I invited him to give a talk at Harvard on Seferis and his work on the occasion of the 100th anniversary from the latter's birth. Seferis was born in Vouvla, near Smyrna, that major center of the Greek-speaking world in Asia Minor, on March 13, 1900. His family moved to Athens in 1914. He studied law in Paris and had a long and successful career as a diplomat, which culminated in his service as Greece's ambassador to the United Kingdom in the period between 1957 and 1961. In 1963, Seferis was awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature. In his award ceremony speech, Anders Österling, permanent secretary of the Swedish Academy at the time, among other things, stressed the following, quote, "In one of his most significant poems, Seferis describes a dream in which a marble head, too heavy for his arms, yet impossible to push aside, fell upon him at the moment of awakening. It is in this state of mind that he sings the praise of the dead, for only in communication with the dead conversing on their astral mentors can bring to the living a hope of peace, confidence, and justice." In Seferis' interpretation, the story of the Argonauts becomes a parable halfway between myth and history, a parable of oarsmen who must fail before they reach their goal, end of quote. I thought that Seamus Heaney, the Ralph Waldo Emerson poet in residence at Harvard at the time, was the most appropriate person to honor the 100th anniversary of Seferis' birth. There had been some important connections of Seferis in his legacy with Harvard. Walter Kaiser, Francis Lee, Hitchinson Professor of English Literature and of Comparative Literature at Harvard, was a friend of Seferis. In 1969, he published his translation of Three Secret Poems from Harvard University Press. In the following year, 1970, the bilingual edition of Igor Stravinsky's Poetics of Music, the Elliot Norton Lectures, delivered in 1939-1940, featured a foreword by George Seferis. 7 years later, the George Seferis Chair of Modern Greek Studies was established. Its first incumbent, Yorgos Savvidis, a long-term visiting professor at Harvard, was a close friend of the poet and an authority in the philological study of his work. At the beginning, Seamus Heaney was a bit hesitant. He knew who Seferis was, a fellow Nobel laureate of his, and he read a couple of his poems. He acknowledged, as he told me, the significance and originality of Seferian poetics, but he was not sure how he could approach or decipher it. I promised that I would try my very best to convey at least some of the most crucial aspects of Seferis' poetics and its historical and political contexts. And Seamus accepted my invitation. Despite his enormous status as one of the most important poets, if not the most influential one of his time, writing in the English language, Seamus was one of the most unpretentious, patient, and modest persons I had ever met. And of course, he was an extremely inspiring and inspired interlocutor. We spent many hours discussing Seferis' work, its intertext and political and historical context, but also Cavafi, T.S. Eliot, Dante. Seamus, being a person of political sensitivities himself, who would miss no opportunity to oppose official British imperialism and colonialism, while stressing his Irish cultural and national identity, was especially interested in the political dimensions of Seferis' poetry. I would explain to him how, in different but comparable ways, in different periods of Seferis' poetic production, his experiences of Asia Minor catastrophe, the Second World War, the occupation of Greece by the Axis powers, the Greek Civil War, and the situation in Cyprus in the 1950s, early 1960s, invested his poetry with a sense of dislocation, ruination, and nostalgia for some sort of archetypal historical totality. Seferis, I stressed, perceived and explored the tragic as a force and condition of cosmic dimensions, because for him, it was existential and historical, individual and collective, transcendental and immanent. Seamus was equally interested in the rhythmical architectonics of Seferis' poetry and in the semantic connotations and nuances of map terms that, as he sensed, translation would fail to convey. At the beginning and the conclusion of our exploration of each particular text, he wanted to hear how the rhythm in the original Greek composition unfolds. On October 24, 2000, in a packed Thompson room at Harvard's Humanities Center, Seamus Heaney delivered his homage to Seferis, one of the most insightful approaches to Seferis' work. He was introduced first by Margaret Alexiou, a most sensitive scholar of Greek literature, the incumbent of the George Seferis chair at the time, and myself, a young assistant professor. Seamus' presentation was followed by a poetry reading. He recited the English translations and tied the original Greek texts. Some months after that memorable event, Seamus sent me the autograph of his to the George Seferis in the Underworld. The poem was first published in Times Literary Supplement in 2004. It was composed as a supplement to both Seamus' own speech on Seferis, delivered at Harvard in 2000, and Seferis' Epiaspalathon on Ghost Bushes. In his homage to Seferis, Heaney focused on a fundamental aspect of Seferis' work, a frequent oscillation between, on the one hand, an uncompromised loyalty to his art, which is not or should not necessarily become a discursive arena for an unmediated exploration of pressing current historical political issues, and on the other, an urge to take sides in such matters explicitly. Heaney felt sympathy for this sort of dilemma. Commenting on a famous line by Keats in his homage to Seferis, Heaney argued, quote, "Heard melodies are sweet, but those unheard are sweeter." I want you to consider a lousy pun and invite you to think of an alternative spelling for heard. If the line were to begin with H-E-R-D, heard melodies are sweet, for example, everything would be different. You would be in the green world of the Cheka rather than the world of the Grecian herb, in a political dictatorship rather than a political rhetoric. Once you drop the A from the participle heard, you cross from the land of individual attentiveness and fully stimulated consciousness to the land of prescribed consensus and narcotic bonding. And you come by that quick route to an awareness of how poetry and music and the arts in general are not to be dictated to, but must be kept to their own courses and purposes. What lies between the heard and heard, H-E-R-D, is a space established by a phrase like, quote, "the government of the tongue," end of quote, a space where the status of the genitive is in doubt, if not in dispute. Does the government of the tongue mean that the tongue is free and undictated too? Or does it mean the very opposite? Over the years, I have been drawn to poets who stood their ground in the space where these two meanings contended. Poets, that is, who wrote out of an awareness that is their language rather than their leader that dictated to them. End of quote. Seferis stood his ground in the space outlined by Heaney. He was a political poet in the broader sense of the term, more directly so than, say, Cavafy, despite the often cryptic character of his aesthetics. Not rarely, his public images and functions as a diplomat and as a major poet, public intellectual, supplemented each other. Supplement used here in its Derridean sense. His journals are replete with confessions, perhaps not always spontaneous ones, of experiences of strong tension between his two main public roles. Either silent, reticent, or spelled out, Seferis' stance on issues of public interest was almost always political. It is as such that his so-called silence in the first 2 years of the dictatorship in Greece was interpreted. In 1969, 3 days after the celebration of the Greek Independence Day by the colonels, on March 28, Seferis denounced the dictatorship in a declaration read on BBC. In addition to its explicit political message, Seferis' statement referring to Aeschylus conveyed a sense of tragedy that recurs every time high hubris is committed. Quote, we are consciously or unconsciously tortured by the drama of this tragic end, as happens in the primordial choruses of Aeschylus. End of quote. 2 years after his statement on BBC on March 31st, 1971, 6 months before his death, Seferis wrote his Epiaspalathion on ghost bushes, a topical poetic commentary on a passage from Plato's Republic, in which the eventual torture inflicted upon that despicable Pamphylian tyrant of the Eros is described. It is as a self-referential sequel to that Seferian poem that Heaney composed to George Seferis in the Underworld a few months after the celebration at Harvard of the 100th anniversary of Seferis' birth. The setting described in Seferis' poem and its diachronic emblematic political overtones are viewed by Heaney as an exemplum of the activation on the part of politically alert poets to the expressive forcefulness of their language. The reference to Aspalathy in Seferis' text, through complex thematic and metaphorical associations, triggers off in Heaney's memory the word Schengans, a word of his native dialect, obliterated in dominant English, signifying a kind of wild lily in Ulster Scots. In Heaney's poem, this term, etymologically related also to sword, becomes a, quote, dialect blade. It is invested with discursive and political dynamism comparable to that of Seferis' Aspalathy. In other words, as happens with Aspalathy in the Seferian text, in his composition, Schengens is transformed into what I would call a marked mytheme, that is, a condensed, associative, discursive encapsulation of cultural memory, mythology, poetic profundity, political awareness. I said before that often the tragic is understood by Seferis as a condition which determines diverse domains of human action and which at times acquires the power of a cosmic force. This conceptualization of the tragic is related to a quasi pre-Socratic view of the world and of humans' position in it. That is, a worldview in which physical elements appear to be subjected to conditions comparable to those defining human life. Hubris in individual or collective human life should be avoided, as the sun in the famous Heraclitan statement must avoid transgressing the boundaries of its allotted course, lest it be punished by Erinyes. Such multi-layered associations are activated and expressed in a forceful, compact manner in a short text from a book of exercises from the second book of exercises. Quote, whenever the light dances, I speak justly, end of quote. In this poetic statement, four of the most important elements, dimensions of Seferis' thematics and broader approach to art and the world are intricately united. Time, light, rhythm, justice. In addition to the apparent visual associations of Seferis' reference to light here, the connection through the elastic energy of dance-like rhythm, the connection of this cosmic element, light, with the socio-ethic category of justice, invests his discourse with an archetypal interdiscursivity. This interdiscursivity, in different versions and nuances, permeates almost the whole spectrum of Seferis' literary production. Manifestations of the conjunction of some or less often of all of the four of these elements can be traced already in his early poems, especially in his Mythistorum. There, justice is at times linked to the ultimate end on a cosmic level, balancing function of the cancellation of subjective temporality by death. Other times, in the same poem, light acquires the climatic potential of a socio-ethic principle. In his Linopedia, the search for justice, which in the poem Asini is associated with the desire to escape the supremacy of primordial vindictive forces the Aeschylean humanities. So in Cryptopedia, the search for justice is juxtaposed to a space depicted in chiaroscuro, a space which delineates the poetic subject's apocalyptic experiencing of temporality. However, it is in the subtly political work Thrash, Kichli, completed in October 1946, amidst one of the most dramatic political turbulence in Greece, that the conjunction of light, time, and justice achieves an ultimate tragic escalation. Tragic in the Hegelian sense of the term. In this work, light, depicted in its opposition or rather inextricable coexistence with darkness, becomes a powerful symbol, a distinctive Seferian mythim. The angelic and black light in Thrash permeates the whole course of the historically and politically conditioned existential odyssey that is entailed by the narrating persona's desire to arrive at the intersection of cosmic and human justice. Sing, little Antigone, sing, sing. I'm not speaking to you about things past. I'm speaking about love. Adorn your hair with the thorns of the sun, dark girl. Scorpion's heart has set. The tyrant in man is gone. And all the daughters of the open sea, Nereids, Grey, hasten to the shimmering of the rising deity. Whoever has never loved, we love in the light. Lucian seems to have been right. The Asphodel mentors exist only in poets' imagination. Seferis and Heaney will never meet down there. However, the memory of mortals has stored the few but crucial elective affinities between their worlds, and this is some sort of immortality. Thank you. Επί ασπαλάθων. Ήταν ωραίο το Σούνιο τη μέρα εκείνη του Ευαγγελισμού, πάλι με την άνοιξη. Λιγοστά παράσινα φύλλα γύρω στις κουβιασμένες πέτρες, το κόκκινο χώμα και ασπάλαθη, δείχνοντας έτοιμα τα μεγάλα τους βελόνια και τους κίτρινους ανθούς. Απόμακρα, οι αρχαίες κολόνες, χορδές μια σάρπας αντιχούν ακόμη. Γαλήνη. Τι μπορεί να μου θύμισε τον αυδείο εκείνο. Μια λέξη στον Πλάτωνα θα δω, χαμένη στο μυαλού τα βλάκια. Το όνομα του κίτρινου θάμνου δεν άλλαξε από εκείνους τους καιρούς. Το βράδυ βρήκα την περικοπή. Τον έδεσαν χειροπόδαλα, μας λέει. Τον έβριξαν χάμο και τον έγδαβαν, τον έσυβαν παράμερα. Τον καταξέσκισαν απάνω στους αγκαθερούς ασπάλαθους και πήγαν και τον πέταξαν στον Τάρταρο, κουρέλι. Έτσι, στον κάτω κόσμο, πλέβουνε τα κρίματά του ο Παμφίλιος Αυδιαίος, ο Πανάθλιος Στίβανος. 31 του Μάρτη, 1971.
On Aspalathi, translated by Keeley and Sherard. Zunyan was lovely that spring day, the feast of the Annunciation. Sparse green leaves surround rust-colored stone, red earth and Aspalathi, with their huge thorns and their yellow flowers already out. In the distance, the ancient columns, strings of a harp still vibrating. Peace. What could have made me think of Arthiaos? Possibly a word in Plato, buried in the mind's furrows. The name of the yellow bush hasn't changed since his time. That evening, I found the passage. They bound him hand and foot, it says. They flung him down and flayed him. They dragged him along, gashing his flesh on thorny Aspalathi. And they went and threw him into Tartarus, torn to shreds. In this way, Arthiaos, the terrible Pamphylian tyrant, paid for his crimes in the netherworld.
Thank you. So Nate, could you please introduce yourself and read Heaney's poem on Seferis?
Hi everyone, I'm Nate Herder, and I'll be reading to George Seferis in the Underworld. The men began arguing about the spiky bushes that were in brilliant yellow bloom on the slopes. Were they caltrop or gorse? That reminds me of something, said George. I don't know that greeny stuff about your feet is asphodel, and rightly so, but why do I think shaggins? And of a spring day in your days of 71, Poseidon making waves in sea and air around Cape Sunion, its very name all ozone breeze and cavern boom, too utterly this worldly, George, for you, intent upon an otherworldly scene somewhere just beyond the summit ridge, the cutting edge of not remembering. The bloody light, to hell with it. Close eyes and concentrate. Not crown of thorns, not scepter reed or Herod's court, but ha, you had it, a harrowing, yes, in hell, the hapless spikes that Plato told of, the tyrant's fate in a passage you would quote. They bound him hand and foot, they flung him down and flayed him, gashing his flesh on thorny Aspalathy, and threw him into Tartarus, torn to shreds, as was only right for a tyrant. But still, for you, maybe, too much of the right to black and white, if still your chance to strike against his ilk, a last word meant to break your much contested silence. And for me, a chance to test the edge of Shaggins, dialect blade, hoar and harder and more hand to hand than what is common usage nowadays, sedge, marshmallow, rubber dagger stuff.
Thank you, Nate. And now I suggest that we listen to Seferis himself, reading poem number 10 from his Mythistorima, and his reading will be followed by Seamus Heaney's reading of the same poem.
Ο τόπος μας είναι κλειστός. Όλο βουνά που έχουν σκεπεί το χαμηλό ουρανό μέρα και νύχτα. Δεν έχουμε ποτάμια, δεν έχουμε πηγάδια, δεν έχουμε πηγές. Μονάχα λίγες στέρνες άδειες και αυτές που ηχούν και που τις προσκυνούμε. Ήχο στεκάμενο κούφιο, ίδιο με τη μοναξιά μα, ίδιο με την αγάπη μα, ίδιο με τα σώματά μα. Μα φαίνεται παράξενο που κάποτε μπορέσαμε να χτίσουμε τα σπίτια, τα καλύβια και τι τάνε μα. Η γάμη μα, τα δροσερά στεφάνια και τα δάχτυλα γίνονται νίγματα ανεξήγητα για την ψυχή μα. Πώ γεννηθήκαν. Πώς δυναμώσανε τα παιδιά μας. Ο τόπος μας είναι κλειστός. Τον κλείνουν οι δυο μαύρες συμπληγάδες. Στα λιμάνια την Κυριακή σαν κατεβούμενα να σάνουμε, βλέπουμε να φωτίζονται στο λιόγερμα σπασμένα ξύλα από ταξίδια που δεν τέλειωσαν. Σώματα που δεν ξέρουν πια πώς να αγαπήσουν.
I will read 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sections, but 5 of them are very brief. The first one, section 10, is, I understand, a very famous one. Our country is a shut-in place, all mountains, and the mountains roofed by a low sky day and night. We have no rivers, we have no wells, we have no fountains. Only some cisterns, empty. They ring and are to us objects of worship. A sound stagnant, hollow, like our solitude, like our love, and like our bodies. It seems to us strange that once we were able to build these houses of ours, these huts, these sheepfolds, and our marriages, the dewy garlands, the marriage fingers, have become insoluble riddles for our souls. How were they born, our children? How then did they grow up? Our country is a shut-in place. It is enclosed by the two black clashing rocks. And when we go on Sundays down to the harbor for a breath of our air, we see, lit by the sunset, the broken timbers of unfinished journeys. bodies that know no longer.
Good, okay, so that was same as Heaney.
It's a poem, just a little more. The translation is by Rex Warner. Λίγο ακόμα θα ειδούμε τις αμυγδαλιές να ανθίζουν, τα μάρμαρα να λάμπουν στον ήλιο, τη θάλασσα να κυματίζει. Λίγο ακόμα να σηκωθούμε λίγο ψηλότερα. Just a little more, and we shall see the almond trees in blossom, the marbles shining in the sun, the sea, the curling waves. Just a little more. Let us rise just a little higher. Thank you.
Thank you. And now, King of Assini will be read by Cleo Takas and Lubi Kyriakidi. Please again introduce yourselves and mention the translator, Lubi. So, Cleo.
Hi, everyone. I'm Cleo, and I'll be reading. Ημερολόγιο καταστρώματος Α, ο βασιλιάς της Ασίνης.
Κλειώ, είναι η candidate in comparative literature.
Yes, hi. ο βασιλιάς της Ασίνης. Ασίνην τε, Λιάδα. Κοιτάξαμε όλο το πρωί γύρω-γύρω το κάστρο, αρχίζοντας από το μέρος του ίσκιου, εκεί που η θάλασσα πράσινη και χωρίς αναλαμπή, το στήθος σκοτωμένου παγωνιού μας δέχτηκε όπως ο καιρός, χωρίς κανένα χάσμα. Οι φλέβες του βράχου κατέβαιναν από ψηλά, στριμμένα κλίματα γυμνά, πολύκλωνα, ζωντανεύοντας το άγγιγμα του νερού, καθώς το μάτι, ακολουθώντας τες, πάλευε να ξεφύγει από το κουραστικό λίκνισμα, χάνοντας δύναμη ολοένα. Από το μέρος του ήλιου, ένας μακρύς γυαλός, ολάνυχτος, και το φως τρίβοντας διαμαντικά τα μεγάλα τείχη. Κανένα πλάσμα ζωντανό, τα αγριοπερίστερα φευγάτα και ο βασιλιάς της Ασίνης που τον γυρεύουμε 2 χρόνια τώρα, άγνωστος, λησμονισμένος από όλους και από τον Όμηρο μόνο μία λέξη στην Ιλιάδα και εκείνη αβέβαιη, ρηγμένη εδώ σαν την εντάφια χρυσή προσωπίδα. Την άγγιξες, θυμάσαι τον ήχο της, κούφιο μέσα στο φως σαν το στεγνό πιθάρι στο σκαμμένο χώμα. Και ο ίδιος ήχος μες στη θάλασσα με τα κουπιά μας. Ο βασιλιάς της Ασίνης, ένα κενό, κάτω την προσωπίδα, παντού μαζί μας, κάτω από ένα όνομα, Ασίνιντε, Ασίνιντε. Και τα παιδιά του αγάλματα, και οι πόθοι του φτερουγίσματα πουλιών και ο αγέρας τα διαστήματα των στοχασμών του και τα καράβια του αραγμένα σάφαντο λιμάνι. Κάτω από την προσωπίδα ένα κενό, πίσω από τα μεγάλα μάτια, τα κάμπυλα χείλια, τους βοστρίχους, ανάγλυφα στο μαλαματένιο σκέπασμα της ύπαρξής μας, ένα σημείο σκοτεινό που ταξιδεύει σαν το ψάρι μέσα στην αυγινή γαλήνη του πέλαγου και το βλέπεις. Ένα κενό παντού μαζί μας και το πουλί που πέταξε τον άλλο χειμώνα με σπασμένη φτερούγα, σκήνομα ζωής και η νέα γυναίκα που έφυγε να παίξει με τα σκυλόδοντα του καλοκαιριού και η ψυχή που γύρεψε τσιρίζοντας τον κάτω κόσμο και ο τόπος σαν το μεγάλο πλατανόφυλλο που παρασέρνει ο χήμαρος του ήλιου με τα αρχαία μνημεία και τη σύγχρονη θλίψη. Και ο ποιητής αργοπορεί κοιτάζοντας τις πέτρες και αναρωτιέται, υπάρχουν άραγε ανάμεσα στις χαλασμένες τούτες γραμμές, τις ακμές, τις εχμές, τα κύλα και τις καμπύλες. Υπάρχουν άραγε εδώ που συναντιέται το πέρασμα της βροχής, του αγέρα και της φθοράς. Υπάρχουν η κίνηση του προσώπου, το σχήμα της στοργής εκείνων που λιγόστεψαν τόσο παράξενα μέσα στη ζωή μας, αυτών που απόμειναν σκιές κυμάτων και στοχασμοί με την απεραντοσύνη του πελάγου. Ή μήπως όχι, δεν απομένει τίποτα, παρά μόνο το βάρος, η νοσταλγία του βάρους μιας ύπαρξης ζωντανής, εκεί που μένουμε τώρα ανυπόστατοι, λυγίζοντας σαν τα κλονάρια της φρικτής ιτιάς, σοριασμένα μες στη διάρκεια της απελπισίας, ενώ το ρέμα, κίτρινο, κατεβάζει αργά βούρλα, ξεριζωμένα μες στο βούρκο, εικόνα μορφής που μαρμάρωσε με την απόφαση μιας πίκρας παντοτινής. ο ποιητής ένα κενό. Ασπιδοφόρος ο ήλιος ανέβαινε πολεμώντας και από το βάθος της σπηλιάς μια νυχτερίδα τρομαγμένη χτύπησε πάνω στο φως σαν τη σαΐτα πάνω στο σκουτάρι. Ασύνυντε, ασύνυντε. Να ήταν αυτή ο βασιλιάς της Ασύνης που τον γυρεύουμε τόσο προσεκτικά σε τούτη την ακρόπολη, γκίζοντας κάποτε με τα δάχτυλά μας την αφή του πάνω στις πέτρες. Ασύνη, καλοκαίρι 38, Αθήνα, Γενάρη 40.
Thank you. Ruby?
Hi, I'm Booby. I am a first year in classical philology in the classics department, and this translation is by Rex Warner. The King of Asine. Asininte, the Iliad. All that morning, we looked at the citadel from every angle. We began from the side in the shadow, where the sea, green, without brilliance, breast of a slain peacock, received us like time that has no break in it. From high above, the veins in the rock descended, twisted vines, leafless, many-branched, regaining life at the touch of water, while the eye, following them, strove to escape the weary rocking motion and gradually lost strength. On the sunny side, a long and open beach, and the light polishing jewels on the massy walls. No living creature. The wild pigeons had gone, and the King of Asine, our quest for 2 years now, unknown, forgotten by everyone, even by Homer. Just one word in the Iliad, and that word doubtful, thrown down here like the gold sepulchral mask. You tapped it. Do you remember how it rang? Hollow in the light, like a dry jar in dug earth. And our oars in the sea made the same sound, the King of Asine, an emptiness beneath the mask, everywhere with us, beneath a name. Asininte, Asininte. And his children, statues, and his desires, the beat of birds' wings and the wind blowing through the spaces of his thoughts, and his ships moored in a vanished harbor under the mask. An emptiness. Behind the great eyes, the curved lips, the curling locks embossed on the gold covering of our lives, a moving darkness, swimming like the fish in the dawn calm of the sea, and you are watching it, an emptiness everywhere with us. And the bird that flew away the other winter with a broken wing, the sanctuary of life, and the young woman who went off to play with the dog's teeth of summer, and the soul which, twittering, sought the underworld, and the country, like a great plain leaf dragged down by the torrent of the sun with the ancient monuments and the present sorrow. And the poet lingers, looks at the stones and asks himself, do they still exist then, among these broken lines, edges, points, hollows, curves, do they still exist? Here at the meeting place of rain, wind, ruin, do they exist? The movement of the face, the form and fashion of the tenderness of those who so strangely have dwindled in our life. Of those who remained, shadows of waves and thoughts with the limitless expanse of the open sea? Or no, perhaps what remains is only the weight, the craving for the weight of a living creature, here where we now remain unsubstantial, leaning over, like twigs of the dreadful willow heaped together in the continuity of hopelessness, while slowly the yellow stream bears down mud with uprooted reeds, image of a face that has returned to stone with the decision of an everlasting bitterness, the poet and emptiness. Shield bearing, the sun was climbing like a warrior, and from the depths of the cave, a frightened bat struck upon the light as an arrow strikes a buckler. Asininte, Asininte. Could this have been the King of Asine, for whom with such great care we searched as we went about this Acropolis, feeling sometimes with our fingers his very touch upon the stones?
Thank you, Luby, thanks. So now, Calliope and Dilana will read ένας γέροντας στην Ακροποταμιά. Calliope.
Ωραία. Ένας γέροντας στην Ακροποταμιά. Κι όμως, πρέπει να λογαριάσουμε πώς προχωρούμε. Να αισθάνεσαι δεν φτάνει, μήτε να σκέπτεσαι, μήτε να κινείσαι, μήτε να κινδυνεύει το σώμα σου στην παλιά πολεμίστρα, όταν το λάδι ζεματιστό και το λιωμένο μολύβι αυλακώνουνε τα τυχιά. Κι όμως, πρέπει να λογαριάσουμε κατά πού προχωρούμε. Όχι καθώς ο πόνος μας το θέλει και τα πεινασμένα παιδιά μας και το χάσμα της πρόσκλησης των συντρόφων από τον αντίπερα γυαλό. Μήτε καθώς το ψιθυρίζει το μελανιασμένο φως στο πρόχειρο νοσοκομείο, το φαρμακευτικό λαμπύρισμα στο προσκέφαλο του παλικαριού που χειρουργήθηκε το μεσημέρι. Αλλά με κάποιον άλλο τρόπο. Μπορεί να θέλω να πω καθώς το μακρύ ποτάμι που βγαίνει από τις μεγάλες λίμνες, τις κλειστές βαθιά στην Αφρική, κι ήτανε κάποτε θεός, και έπειτα γέννηκε δρόμος, και δωρητής, και δικαστής, και δέλτα, που δεν είναι ποτέ του το ίδιο, κατά που δίδασκαν οι παλαιοί γραμματισμένοι. Κι ωστόσο μένει πάντα το ίδιο σώμα, το ίδιο στρώμα και το ίδιο σημείο, ο ίδιος προσανατολισμός. Δεν θέλω τίποτε άλλο παρά να μιλήσω απλά, να μου δοθεί ετούτη η χάρη. Γιατί και το τραγούδι το φορτώσαμε με τόσες μουσικές που σιγά σιγά βουλιάζει και την τέχνη μας τη στολίσαμε τόσο πολύ που φαγώθηκε από τα μαλάματα το πρόσωπό της. Κι είναι καιρός να πούμε τα λιγοστά μας λόγια, γιατί η ψυχή μας αύριο κάνει πανιά. Αν είναι ανθρώπινος ο πόνος, δεν είμαστε άνθρωποι μόνο για να πονούμε. Γι' αυτό συλλογίζομαι τόσο πολύ τούτες τις μέρες το μεγάλο ποτάμι. Αυτό το νόημα που προχωρεί ανάμεσα σε βότανα και σε χόρτα και ζωντανά που βόσκουν και ξεδιψούν και ανθρώπους που σπέρνουν και που θερίζουν και σε μεγάλους τάφους ακόμη και μικρές κατοικίες των νεκρών. Αυτό το ρέμα που τραβάει το δρόμο του και που δεν είναι τόσο διαφορετικό από το αίμα των ανθρώπων και από τα μάτια των ανθρώπων όταν κοιτάζουν ίσια πέρα, χωρίς το φόβο μέσα στην καρδιά τους, χωρίς την καθημερινή τρεμούλα για τα μικροπράγματα ή έστω και για τα μεγάλα. Όταν κοιτάζουν ίσια πέρα, καθώς ο στρατοκόπος που συνήθισε να αναμετρά το δρόμο του μετάστρα. Όχι όπως εμείς, την άλλη μέρα, κοιτάζοντας το κλειστό περιβόλι στο κοιμισμένο αράπικο σπίτι. Πίσω από τα καφασωτά, το δροσερό περιβολάκι να αλλάζει σχήμα, να μεγαλώνει και να μικραίνει. Αλλάζοντας, καθώς κοιτάζαμε κι εμείς, το σχήμα του πόθου μας και της καρδιάς μας, στη στάλα του μεσημεριού. Εμείς, το υπομονετικό ζυμάρι ενός κόσμου που μας διώχνει και που μας πλάθει, πιασμένοι στα πλουμισμένα δίχτυα μιας ζωής που ήτανε σωστή και έγινε σκόνη και βούλιαξε μέσα στην άμμο, αφήνοντας πίσω της μονάχα εκείνο το απροσδιόριστο λίκνισμα που μας ζάλισε μιας αψηλής φοινικιάς.
Thanks, Calliope. Thanks a lot. Ilana?
An Old Man on the Riverbank, translated by Keeley and Sherard. And yet we should consider how we go forward. To feel is not enough, nor to think, nor to move, nor to put your body in danger in front of an old loophole when scalding oil and molten lead furrow the walls. And yet we should consider towards what we go forward. Not as our pain would have it, and our hungry children, and the chasm between us and the companions calling from the opposite shore. Nor as the bluish light whispers it in an improvised hospital, or the pharmaceutic glimmer on the pillow of the youth operated on at noon. But it should be in some other way. I would say like the long river that emerges from the great lakes enclosed deep in Africa. That was once a god and then became a road and a benefactor, a judge and a delta. That is never the same as the ancient wise men taught. And yet always remains the same body, the same bed, and the same sign, the same orientation. I want nothing more than to speak simply, to be granted that grace, because we've loaded even our song with so much music that it's slowly sinking. And we've decorated our art so much that its features have been eaten away by gold. And it's time to say our few words, because tomorrow our soul sets sail. If pain is human, we are not human beings merely to suffer pain. That's why I think so much these days about the great river, this meaning that moves forward among herbs and greenery, and beasts that graze and drink, men who sow and harvest, great tombs even, and small habitations of the dead. This current that goes its way, and that is not so different from the blood of men, from the eyes of men when they look straight ahead without fear in their hearts, without the daily tremor for trivialities or even for important things, when they look straight ahead like the traveler who is used to gauging his way by the stars. Not like us the other day, gazing at the enclosed garden of a sleepy Arab house. Behind the lattices, the cool garden changing shape, growing larger and smaller. We too changing as we gazed, the shape of our desire and our hearts. At noon's precipitation, we, the patient, dough of a world that throws us out and needs us. Caught in the embroidered nets of a life that was as it should be, and then became dust and sank into the sands, leaving behind it only that vague, dizzying sway of a tall palm tree.
David Elman, myself, will read Seferis' Elaine. So I'll read the Greek first. Ελένη, τεύκλος. Εσγίνεν αλίαν Κύπρο, ου με θέσπισε νικήν Απόλλων, όνομα νησιωτικών Σαλαμίνα Θέμενων της εκεί χάριν πάτρας. Ελένη, ου κύλθον εσγίν τροάδ, αλίδωλον νύν. Άγγελος, τι φύς, νεφέλης αβάλλος ήχομεν πόνους πέρι. Ευρυπίδης, Ελένη. Τα ειδόνια δεν σ' αφήνουνε να κοιμηθεί στις πλάτρες. Αειδόνι τροπαλό, μες στον ανασασμό των φύλων, σ' υποδορίζεις τη μουσική δροσιά του δάσους, στα χωρισμένα σώματα και στις ψυχές, αυτών που ξέρουν πως δεν θα γυρίσουν. Τυφλή φωνή, που ψηλαφείς μέσα στη νυχτωμένη μνήμη, βήματα και χειρονομίες. Δεν θα τολμούσα να πω φιλήματα. Και το πικρό τρικύμισμα της ξαγριεμένης κλάδας. Τα ειδόνια δεν σ' αφήνουν να κοιμηθείς στις Πλάτευες. Ποιες είναι οι Πλάτευες? Ποιος το γνωρίζει τούτο το νησί? Έζησα τη ζωή μου ακούγοντας ονόματα πρωτάκουστα, καινούριους τόπους, καινούριες τρέλες των ανθρώπων ή των θεών. Η μοίρα μου που κυματίζει ανάμεσα στο στενό σπαθί ενός έαντα και μια άλλη σαλαμίνα, με έφερε εδώ σε αυτό το γερογιάλι. Το φεγγάρι βγήκε από το πέλαγο σαν Αφροδίτη. Σκέπασε τ' άστρα του τοξότη, τώρα πάει να βρει την καρδιά του σκορπιού και όλα τα αλλάζει. Πού είναι η αλήθεια? Ήμουν κι εγώ στον πόλεμο τοξότης. Το ριζικό μου ενός ανθρώπου που ξαστόχησε. Αηδώνει ποιητάρι, σαν και μια τέτοια νύχτα στα κοθαλάσσια του Πρωτέα, σ' άκουσαν οι σκλάβες παρτιάτισες και έσυραν το θρήνο και ανάμεσό τους. Ποιος θα το έλεγε? Η Ελένη. Αυτή που κυνηγούσαμε χρόνια στο Σκάμανδρο. Ήταν εκεί, στα χείλια της Ερήμου. Την άγγιξα, μου μίλησε. «Δεν είναι αλήθεια, δεν είναι αλήθεια», φώναζε. «Δεν μπήκα στο γαλαζόπορο καβάδι. Ποτέ δεν πάτησα την αδρεμένη κρύα». Με το βαθύ στιθόδεσμο, τον ήλιο στα μαλλιά και αυτό το ανάστημα, ίσκυε και χαμόγελα παντού, στους ώμους, στους μυρούς, στα γόνατα, ζωντανό δέρμα και τα μάτια με τα μεγάλα βλέφαρα ήταν εκεί, στην όχθη ενός δέλτα. Και στην τρία, τίποτε στην τρία, ένα είδωλο. Έτσι το θέλανε Θεοί. Και ο Πάρης με έναν ίσκιο πλάγιαζε σαν να ήταν πλάσμα τόφιο. Και εμείς σφαζόμασταν για την Ελένη 10 χρόνια. Μεγάλος πόνος είχε πέσει στην Ελλάδα. Τόσα κορμιά ρηγμένα στα σαγόνια της θάλασσας, στα σαγόνια της γης. Τόσες ψυχές δοσμένες στις μιλόπετρες, σαν το σιτάρι. Και οι ποταμοί φουσκώναν με στη λάσπη το αίμα για ένα λινό κυμάτισμα για μια νεφέλη. Μια σπεταλούδα στήναγμα, το πούπουλο ενός κύκνου. Για ένα πουκάμισο διανό, για μια Ελένη. Και ο αδερφός μου, αηδώνει, αηδώνει, αηδώνει. Τι είναι Θεός, τι μη Θεός και τι ήταν αμεσό τους. Τα αηδόνια δεν σ' αφήνουν να κοιμηθεί στις πλάτερες. Τα κρυσμένο πουλί στην Κύπαρο, τη θαλασσοφύλλητη, που έταξαν για να μου θυμίζει την πατρίδα. Άραξα μοναχός μου αυτό το παραμύθι. Αν είναι αλήθεια πως αυτό είναι παραμύθι. Αν είναι αλήθεια πως οι ανθρώποι δεν θα ξαναπιάσουν τον παλιό δόλο των Θεών. Αν είναι αλήθεια πως κάποιος άλλος τεύκρος, ύστερα από χρόνια, ή κάποιος έαντας, ή πυρίαμος, ή εκάβη, ή κάποιος άγνωστος, ανώνυμος, πως τόσο είδε ένα σκάμαντρο να ξεχυλάει κουφάβια, δεν το έχει μες στη μοίρα του να ακούσει με δατοφόρους που έρχονται να πούνε, πως τόσος πόνος, τόση ζωή, πήγαν στην Άβυσσο για να πουκάμισο διανό, για μια Ελένη. David?
Yes, now I'll read Seferis' Helen in the translation of Rex Warner. There's an epigraph taken from Euripides' Helen, three quotations from that play. The first, Teucer's line. Teucer is the archer and the brother of Ajax who died at Troy. Toward sea-surrounded Cyprus, where Apollo said I was to settle down and call my city's name Salamis, in memory of my old island home. The second quotation is Helen. I never went to Troy, only a phantom went. And finally, the messenger. What's this? Then did we toil in vain there simply for a cloud? The nightingales will never let you go to sleep at Plotris. Shy nightingale, in the shuddering breath of the leaves, giver of dewy music, the dew of the forest, to bodies parted each from each, to the souls of those who know that they will not come back again. Blind voice, in the darkened memory, turning over footsteps, gestures of hands, I dare not say kisses. For the bitter, and the bitter heave of the heart of a slave grown savage. The nightingales will never let you go to sleep at Plotris. Plotris, what is it? Who is it knows this island? I have lived my life hearing names heard for the first time. new places and new madnesses, whether of men or gods. My own fate, which wavers between the final sword of an Ajax and another Salamis, has brought me to this shore. Here the moon has risen from the sea like Aphrodite, has blotted out the archer, and now she goes to the heart of the scorpion, changing everything. Oh, truth, where are you? I also was an archer in the war, my fate that of a man who missed the mark. Melodious nightingale, on such a night as this, the Spartan slave girls heard you on Proteus's beach and lifted their lament. And among them there was, who could have thought it, Helen. She, our pursuit for years beside the Scamander. She was there at the desert's edge. I touched her. She spoke to me. It is not true. It is not true, she cried. I never went aboard that colored ship. I never trod the ground of manly Troy. Deep girdled the sun in her hair with that way of standing, the print of shadows and the print of smiles on shoulders, thighs and knees, the lively skin, the eyes and the great eyelids, she was there on the banks of a delta. And at Troy? Nothing. At Troy, a phantom. So the gods willed it. And Paris lay with a shadow as though it were solid flesh. And we were slaughtered for Helen 10 long years. Great pain had fallen on Greece. So many bodies thrown to jaws of the sea, to jaws of the earth. So many souls given up to the millstones to be crushed like corn. And the muddy beds of the rivers sweated with blood for a wavering linen garment, a thing of air, for a butterfly's jerk, for a swan's down, for a Helen. And my brother? Oh, nightingale, nightingale, what is God? What is not God? What is in between? The nightingales will never let you go to sleep at Plotinus. Tearful bird at sea-kissed Cyprus, ordained for me to remind me of my country, I moored alone and brought this fairy story, if it is true that it is a fairy story. If it is true that man will not set in motion once more the old deceit of the gods. If it is true that after many years, some other Teucer, some Ajax maybe, or Priam or Hecuba, or someone quite unknown, nameless, yet one who saw the corpses crown the banks of a Scamander, were not so fated as this, fated to hear the steps of messengers who come to tell him that so much suffering, so much of life fell into the abyss for the sake of an empty garment, for a Helen.
Thanks a lot, David. Now, Calliope and Nate will read Encomi.
Encomi. Ήταν πλατής ο κάμπος και στρωτός. Από μακριά φαινόνταν το γύρισμα χεριών που σκάβαν. Στον ουρανό τα σύννεφα πολλές καμπύλες. Κάπου-κάπου μια σάλπιγγα χρυσή και ρόδινη, το δίλι. Στο λιγοστό χορτάρι και στα αγκάθια τριγυρίζαν ψηλές από βροχάρισες ανάσες. Θα είχε βρέξει. Πέρα στις άκρες τα βουνά που έπαιρναν χρώμα. Κι εγώ προχώρεσα προς τους ανθρώπους που δουλεύαν, γυναίκες και άντρες με ταξίνια σε χαντάκια. Ήταν μια πολιτεία παλιά. Τυχιά, δρόμοι και σπίτια ξεχώριζαν σαν πετρωμένοι νιώνες κυκλόπων. Η ανατομία μιας ξοδεμένης δύναμης, κάτω από το μάτι του αρχαιολόγου, του ναρκοδότη ή του χειρούργου. Φαντάσματα και υφάσματα, χλειδί και χίλια, χωνεμένα. Και τα παραπετάσματα του πόνου διάπλατα ανοιχτά, αφήνοντας να φαίνεται γυμνός και αδιάφορος ο τάφος. Και ανάβλεψα προς τους ανθρώπους που δουλεύαν, τους τεντωμένους ώμους και τα μπράτσα που χτυπούσαν με ένα ρυθμό βαρύ και γρήγορο τούτη την νέκρα, σαν να περνούσε στα χαλάσματα ο τροχός της μοίρας. Άξαφνα, περπατούσα και δεν περπατούσα. Κοίταζα τα πετούμενα πουλιά κι ήταν μαρμαρωμένα. Κοίταζα τον εθέρα του ουρανού κι ήταν θαμπωμένος. Κοίταζα τα κορμιά που πολεμούσαν κι είχαν μείνει κι ανάμεσά τους ένα πρόσωπο το φως να ανηφορίζει. Τα μαλλιά μαύρα χύνουνταν στην τραχυλιά. Τα φρύδια είχανε το φτερούγισμα της χελιδόνας. Τα ρουθούνια καμαρωτά πάνω από τα χείλια και το σώμα έβγαινε από το χεροπάλεμα ξεγυμνωμένο, με τάγουρα βυζιά της οδηγήτρας, χορός ακίνητος. Κι εγώ χαμήλωσα τα μάτια μου τριγύρω, κορίτσια ζύμωναν και ζύμοι δεν αγγίζαν. Γυναίκες γνέθανε, τα αδράχτια δεν γυρίζαν. Αρνιά ποτίζουνταν και η γλώσσα τους στεκόταν πάνω από πράσινα νερά που έμοιαζαν κοιμισμένα. Και ο ζευγάς έμενε με ανάερη τη βουκέντρα. Και ξανακοίταξα το σώμα εκείνο να ανεβαίνει. Είχανε μαζευτεί πολλοί μερμήγκια και τη χτυπούσανε με κοντάρια και δεν τη λαβώναν. Τώρα η κοιλιά της έλαμπε σαν το φεγγάρι. Και πίστευα πως ο ουρανός ήταν η μήτρα που την εγέννησε και την ξανάπαιρνε, μάνα και βρέφος. Τα πόδια της μείναν ακόμη μαρμαρένια και χάθηκαν. Μια ανάληψη. Ο κόσμος ξαναγινόταν όπως ήταν, ο δικός μας, με τον καιρό και με το χώμα. Αρώματα από σκήνο πήραν να ξεκινήσουν στις παλιές πληγές της μνήμης. Κόρφη μέσα στα φύλλα, χίλια υγρά. Κι όλα στεγνώσαν μονομιάς στην πλατωσιά του κάμπου. Στις πέτρας την απόγνωση, στη δύναμη τη φαγωμένη. Στον άδειο τόπο με το λιγοστό χορτάρι και τα αγκάθια. Όπου γλιστρούσε ξέγνιαστο ένα φίδι. Όπου ξοδεύουνε πολύ καιρό για να πεθάνουν.
So thanks, Calliope.
This is Ngomi in the translation of Rex Warner. The plain was wide and level. In the distance, you could see hands turning in the motion of digging. In the sky, the clouds were ringlets. Here and there, a trumpet of gold and rose, the approaching dusk. In the scanty grass and among the thorns, there roamed thin breaths that follow the rain. It must have been raining over there at the edge of the hills that now took on color. And I went forward to the people who were working, women and men with picks working in ditches. It was an ancient city. Walls, streets, and houses there stood out. Fossilized muscles of cyclopean giants, spent power in its anatomy under the eye of archaeologist, anesthetist, or surgeon. Vantums and fabrics, luxury and lips dissolved, and the curtains of suffering drawn right back, revealing the naked, indifferent tomb. And I looked up towards the people who were working, the straining shoulders, the arms striking down a heavy beat, a tattoo on this world of the dead, as if through the ruins, the wheel of fate was rolling. Suddenly I was walking and not walking. I looked at the flying birds, they had turned to stone. I looked at the shining sky, there was amazement in the air. I looked at the struggling bodies, they stood still. And in their midst was a face ascending into the light. Over the neck, the black hair flowed. The eyebrows had the beat of a swallow's wing. The nostrils curled back over the lips. And now the body was rising out of the labor, naked, with the unripe breasts of a virgin, leader of waves, a dancing but no movement. And I turned my eyes down to look about me. I saw girls kneading bread and their hands not touching the dough, women spinning and the spindles did not turn, sheep at the drinking trough, and the sheep's tongue stuck still over the green waters that seemed to be sunk in sleep. And the shepherd stayed with his crook uplifted into the air. And I looked at the ascending body, Multitudes had assembled together, a swarm of ants, and were striking her with spears and not hurting her. And now, as I saw her belly shine out like the moon, this was my belief, that the sky was the womb which bore her and which now was taking her back, mother and babe. Still her feet remained. The feet were of marble. They vanished, an assumption. The world was becoming again what it was, our own, the world of time and of earth. Perfumes of terebinth began to move and stir along the slopes of memory. Breasts on a couch of leaves, moistness of lips, and everything at once dried up in the stretch of the plain, in the wilderness of the stones, in the power eaten away, in the empty land with its scanty grass and the thorns where slithered the body of a snake uncaring, where they spend much time in dying.
Thank you. And our last two poems will be read by Cleotakas.
I will be reading Therino Iliostasi Zita and Ita. Would you prefer for me to go from the Greek to the translation intermittently or to?
First, in the Greek original, then the English translation.
Okay. Therino Iliostasi Zita. Ilefka στο μικρό περιβόλι. Η ανάσα της μετρά τις ώρες σου, μέρα και νύχτα, κλεψίδρα που γεμίζει ο ουρανός. Στη δύναμη του φεγγαριού τα φύλλα της σέρνουν μαύρα πατήματα στον άσπρο τοίχο. Στο σύνορο είναι λιγοστά τα πεύκα, έπειτα μάρμαρα και φωταψίες, και άνθρωποι καθώς είναι πλασμένοι άνθρωποι. Ο κότσιφας όμως τη τυβίζει σαν έρχεται να πιει και ακούς καμιά φορά, φωνή της δεκοχτούρας. Στο μικρό περιβόλι, 10 δρασκελιές. Μπορείς να ειδείς το φως του ήλιου να πέφτει σε 2 κόκκινα γαρούφαλα, σε μία ελιά και λίγο αγιόκλημα. Δέξου ποιος είσαι. Το ποίημα, μη το καταποντίζεις στα βαθιά πλατάνια. Θρέψε το με το χώμα και το βράχο που έχεις. Τα περισσότερα, σκάψε στον ίδιο τόπο να τα βρεις. And I will now read Walter Kaiser's translation. Summer solstice 7. The poplar tree in the little garden, its breathing marks your hours, night and day, a sky-filled clepsydra. Under the moon's brightness, its leaves drag black footsteps across the white wall. On the border, a few pines, then fragments of marble and the lights of the city, and people, the way people usually are. Yet the blackbird twitters when it comes to drink, and at times you hear the voice of the ringdove. 10 steps in the little garden, you can see the sunlight fall on 2 red carnations, on an olive tree and a bit of honeysuckle. Accept who you are. The poem, do not cast it down under the thick plane trees. Nourish it with the earth and rock you have. For better things, dig the same ground to find them. And I will now move to Therino Iliostasi Ita. Το άσπρο χαρτί σκληρός καθρέφτης επιστρέφει μόνο εκείνο που ήσουν. Το άσπρο χαρτί μιλά με τη φωνή σου, τη δική σου τη φωνή, όχι εκείνη που σ' αρέσει. Μουσική σου είναι η ζωή, αυτή που σπατάλησες. Μπορεί να την ξανακερδίσεις αν το θέλεις, αν καρφωθείς σε τούτο το διάφορο πράγμα που σε ρίχνει πίσω εκεί που ξεκίνησες. Ταξίδεψες, είδες πολλά φεγγάρια, πολλούς ήλιους, άγγιξες νεκρούς και ζωντανούς, ένιωσες το πόνο του παλικαριού και το βογγητό της γυναίκας, την πίκρα του άγουρου παιδιού. Ό,τι ένιωσες, σοριάζεται ανυπόστατο αν δεν εμπιστευτείς τούτο το κενό. Ίσως να βρεις εκεί ό,τι νόμισες χαμένο. Τη βλάστηση της νιώτης, το δίκαιο καταποντισμό της ηλικίας. Ζωή σου είναι ό,τι έδωσες. Τούτο το κενό είναι ό,τι έδωσες. Το άσπρο χαρτί. And I will read Walter Kaiser's translation again. So Summer Solstice 8. The blank page, difficult mirror, gives back only what you were. The blank page speaks with your voice, your own voice, not the one you like. Your music is the life you wasted. You could regain it if you wish, if you fasten to this indifferent thing which casts you back where you set out. You have journeyed, have seen many moons, many suns, have touched the dead and the living, have known the sorrow of the young man and the groans of the woman, the bitterness of the boy. All you have experienced falls in an insubstantial heap if you do not trust this void. Perhaps you will find there what you thought lost, the flowering of youth, the rightful sinking of age. Your life is what you gave. This void is what you gave, the blank page.
Thank you, Cleo. Thank you, everybody, for joining us at this modest commemoration of George Seferis. I know this is an extremely hectic period, so I appreciate that you found the time to join us. Thank you so much. Bye.